Hi folks, this is David Kwan here. So in one of my classes this past week, it was an interesting class just because we were assigned a book to read. It was a very short book, about, 150 pages, but the font was big and it was kind of double spaced, so it was really easy reading and, it was still a book, so I had to read a book in 1 week for this class. And in that class, the author of that book, one of the professors in NYU, authored this book, and it was published by NYU. He came to the class as a guest lecturer kind of thing, and it was kind of a good discussion in a way. Although I think some people felt very uncomfortable by the discussion that happened. I'm not going to talk too much about that. It was interesting though. When one of the person asked the author the question, the professor, like, how did you end up, coming to be a social worker? In high school you were involved in civil rights movement and political movements. How did you, growing up in the neighborhood that you were in, in the Bronx, whatnot, and how did you come to be like that? What made you want to become a social worker was the question. And so it is a difficult question to answer, I think, in a lot of ways. And so that's kind of how he answered it, saying, I'm still trying to figure that out myself to this day, how I ended up being a social worker on this path. And it's really difficult for anyone to really say why they ended up having the passion for social work and whatnot. Although I turned that question to me, and I'm not sure if it's such a difficult question. I think more difficult question for me is, why is it that as a social work student, or, if you end up being a social worker, why is it that your interest is so on homelessness and poverty? I think that's more of a difficult question. Why does homelessness matter to me? And I'll probably make a video on that, of me kind of responding to that question later in the future. But, how did I end up being having a BSW and not going for my MSW, and my goal is to be a social worker in the future, and that's my career path. How did I end up that way? I kind of talked about this before, but the my life path towards this is kind of accidental, I had no idea what social work was in high school. Any of that, when I was in high school, I was fascinated by history, and I still am. I was a history nerd. I loved reading about it, and I just loved, because it was like I was reading stories about things that actually happened. And there was so much controversy. We're not actually sure exactly what happened or why it happened, and I love the controversies of this historian saying we have reasons to believe that things happened because of this, and this had this implications because of this evidence and these documents. And then another set of historians would kind of argue, well, no, not actually. There are these other murky areas that we don't really know. And there's all these controversies and stories that we learn from, and then how it connects us to how we are now. I love about that, about history. And I've also had really great history teachers along the way to kind of point me towards that. So, loved history, I applied to like 4 colleges. Every college I applied to as a history major, except one school, which is NYU. I applied saying I want to create a major where I mix history and doing something about it. Using that knowledge of history to do volunteer work or activism or some kind of doing something with knowledge of history and how society works, And NYU emailed me back saying, you applied to the wrong school, which is a school where you can create your own major. You should apply to our other school, this school called School of Social Work. I was like, what the heck is social work? So that's how I came to accidentally to the realm of social work. But I think it makes sense for me why I am passionate about becoming a social worker. It's kind of, I have a lot of influence from my parents, of course, like how many people would, or to their caregivers, if they don't have parents, but if they were raised by grandmother or kin, or they were adopted or something like that, their caregiver or guardian, they have a strong influence, usually, not always, can't speak for everyone, but to me, I think my dad pretty much raised me, and he's a pastor. So for a long time, before I had an issue with Christianity and the Bible and religion itself and whatnot. Before I had that, up till I was like 17, you know, Christianity was my biggest passion. Jesus was my, like, the most important relationship with, about, you know, that to me. It was my dad's influence. He was a pastor, went to so many churches, too many retreats. And so I wanted to be, you know, somebody that serves God and spread his message across the world. And so my desire actually was to be a pastor like my dad, but also to be like a missionary and to really go out to the world and be along with people of other world who are struggling and whatnot, and to really live like they do and spread the message of God. So that was my lifelong passion until I was 17 years old. And then that got shattered. But also important is my mom's influence. My mom is a nurse. She still is. She has been since before I was born. So she's always about serving people and communicating with people and sympathy in the nursing profession is extremely important. Empathy in becoming in the pastoring profession is really important. So those, you know, the fact that my mom and dad are pastors and nurses, I think influenced me greatly about caring about what other people are like. And you know, my dad's a pastor. It's a profession not about making money. You know, my dad's salary is pitiful. It's just really bad. So I didn't really have this message handed down to me as a kid that, you know, you should do something with your life that, you know, gives you a lot of happiness and a lot of wealth. And this emphasis on wealth was not there in my family, and I was the only child. So I think they put a lot of influence on me on that. And I've gone through a lot of different kinds of communities. I've experienced a lot of diversity in my life. You know, I was raised I was born in Korea. I lived there until I was 10. Then I came to the United States, and I felt like it was such a foreign thing. You know, everyone looks so different from me. Everyone speaks a different language. It was so crazy getting used to that in New York, and just seeing that there were Japanese students. It was mostly a white American student, you know, all these American students, just getting used to that. And then we moved to California, and it was just a whole different ballgame. And I experiencing so many kind of different communities, having different friends. My best friends in, you know, elementary school and middle school, you know, they were complete different culture. Mexican-American, Black American. Like, it was so amazingly diverse, and trying to coming to learn these kinds of experiences, I think it made sense to me that, like, diversity is important, that respecting other people is important, and also seeing their differences in experience, seeing how some people had privileges just because of who they were, and some people had extreme difficulties that I wouldn't have or any other people would have just because of who they are. I've started to notice that, and that kind of pointed me towards, well, that's not right. There should be a social justice and equality and equal access and for everyone involved. How do we fix this? And, you know, in Korean culture, there's a lot of talk. This word gets used up a lot, you know, helping the 가난한 사람. 가난한 사람 is a poor person or like working class person, a person struggling in the lower classes. And there's always kind of an emphasis in Korean culture in considering them, being considerate of them and thinking about them. And so, you know, that's always been in the back of my mind as a cultural kind of ingrained thing. So I think that kind of pushed me forward to this idea of social work. And I think I've received some comments saying you can help people without becoming a social worker, you know, without a social work degree or whatever. And I think that's kind of true. But I think the more I learned about social work, the more I've been trained in this profession, I guess it's just because I'm more deeply ingrained into it, but just helping people is different than when you have standards on how you're supposed to help people. There are ethical standards that all social workers must and should abide by. It's not just helping people. If anybody out there just goes to a homeless person and starts communicating with that person and starts, you know, providing kind of a therapy to that person by listening to their life stories and giving money and whatnot, that's great. But what if he messes up? Who holds him accountable to the person that helps? Like, what if he ends up, you know, just accidentally, let's just say unintentionally, You know, he helps this homeless person out, and this homeless person ends up committing suicide two days later because of this interaction. It could happen. Who holds that accountable? Like, who can be held accountable for that? Just random person helping? No one. You know, but social work as a profession does have ethical standards that we are all trained to help people in the most ethical manner possible. So I think that's important. This bothered me recently. I was with a friend, let's say not a friend, but I was with someone, and this person, you know, works in nonprofit world, and what that person does is could be what a social worker does, you know. And this person introduced, this person was hanging out with other groups of people, and you know, this obvious question gets asked a lot, and like, what do you do for a living? And so the person was, I'm a social worker. And a part of me was really bothered by that. I was like, no, you're not a social worker. You know, although what you do is social worky stuff, it bothered me because, well, the degree that this, the training and qualification that this person had is in a way related to social work, like psychology. You know, if you have a master's in psychology, you know, that's, there's a lot of overlap between, like in some of my videos I said, there's a lot of overlap between psychology and social work. Sure, you know, they're both very, it's a profession that's both geared towards the mental well-being of the clients that we serve and the populations that we want to lift up and empower and strengthen. Sure, but it's, I wouldn't call a psychologist a social worker. It's weird because I know there were social workers who didn't have to have social work degrees, but we call them social workers because of what they did and what they said and what they believed in and whatnot. I think even when like a person is doing social worky stuff, there are some things that distinguishes what is a social worker and what is not. And in this modern society, unfortunately, the easiest way to determine that is if you have a degree in social work, specifically a master's degree in social work in a city like New York City. In some other cities, bachelor's in social work counts, but it's in a city like New York City, a bachelor's in social work doesn't really mean as much. You are an aspiring social worker, but you're not technically a social worker with a BSW. What I think really matters is this notion, because social work is, that ethical standard matters. I think the ethical standard of psychology is very similar, but this passion about social justice, this passion about helping the populations who are the most vulnerable, the most voiceless, and creating an atmosphere in society where everyone should help each other and everyone should lift other people up. We shouldn't really look towards people's flaws, but look to their strengths and focus on that. Strength makes perspective. You know, a person in the environment, we don't look at just what the person is doing wrong, but also what society is doing wrong as well. That's an aspect of social justice that social workers care deeply about. I think people can have ideals without even the degrees of social work and be doing social work stuff. And I would say that person is a social worker. But a person who has a different qualification, who I don't think has the ideals of social work, it's hard for me to say that person is a social worker. Not many people get it. You know, I certainly didn't before I got into college. Like, what the heck is social work? You know, why not, if you're just volunteering to help people, why not just volunteer and help people? Why do you have to get a degree in it and spend hundreds of thousands of dollars or whatever to have a degree? And there's now like a discussion now because of college tuition being so high. You know, is it worth it? It's a worthless degree, whatever. There is this kind of good discussion going around which degrees are valuable and which are not. And going away from that, though, I think, no, I'm very passionate about the social work, you know, education thing and whatnot, because it does force you to be hands-on. Internship is mandatory for anyone, doing social work. You have to have that direct practice experience to graduate with the social work degree, whether that be bachelor's or master's. So I think that's important, you know, that kind of experience, that kind of the passion that you have for your client, starting with where the client, I think it's a whole different kind of realm, you know, and I have no idea what human services majors are like or what public administration degrees are like, but I at least know what social work kind of ethics and aspirations are. And to me, I really respect that a lot. You know, I try to respect people the best way that I can. I think for me, one of the most difficult, you know, ethical dilemmas or counter-transference issue is when I have to work with people whose religious faith is such a strong part of their lives that it's what's determining their actions. And sometimes those actions are harmful to others or to themselves, but that action is based on their deep religious faith. To me, that is a very difficult thing for me to address because I'm an atheist. But at the same time, I don't want, you know, I respect freedom of religion. So this kind of fine line between, you know, establishing trust with the client, but at the same time, trying to encourage that client to change his or her behavior to better themselves and to have better relations with other people. That's a challenge of social work, and there are so many ethical dilemmas that come with that. But that's one aspect. You also, as a social worker, I think there's also an important value placed in changing society or having society be respectful to this person, changing the culture, so that it's not only this person that has to change, but everyone else also must change. The system must change. I think that's a really, really important value that social workers place. And so that's kind of how, you know, I think I'm led here. I can't think of any other profession that I see myself so passionate about than social work, you know, partly because of my upbringing, because of my experiences with diversity, and because of my, you know, coming to learn about all these life stories of people that I come to meet, the experiences that I've had. It's not just about helping people, you know, because people are right. I can help people without a social work degree, without being a part of this profession. But it's also about the question of helping people the right way, you know, because even the best of intentions can have disastrous consequences. And I don't want it to be like that. You know, I want the help that I give to be the most ethical, the most evidence-based, the most, you know, that there's people like me, other people like me who consider themselves to be helping people, but there's a network, there's a support network of us doing what we're doing and us making sure that we're doing it the right way. And if we do mess up, if we do make mistakes, and if we hurt people in the process of helping people, that we're held accountable for it. So that there's a body that actually deals with accountability. And that actually exists with, you know, National Association of Social Work. That it wouldn't exist if I was just a random volunteer helping another person. Liability issue is different in that regard. And so, you know, for me, I think that's the most important piece. You know, I want to be able to help people who are the most vulnerable. I want to give back to society, but I want to do it the right and proper way. And to me, in my personal opinion, and for me personally, that requires that I am a part of this social work profession, of this network of social workers, and then I become a social worker myself. That's my long video on this, on why I think, you know, social work is a profession for me. I hope you guys found something good out of this. But yeah. You guys enjoyed. Cheers.